Let's see what we can do.
Okay, geweldig. That's really called problem solving. Creative, out of the box thinking. Okay, so we're up to the Mishnah on Daf Chav Vav Amud Beis. And until now, what we were discussing was how many Kohanim, there's a famous question that's been asked, how many Polak does it take to change a light bulb? Right? Everyone knows the famous joke. But here we need to know how many Kohanim it takes to be makriv a korban. So we learned that a tle, a keves, which is like a small lamb, takes six kohanim. There were five kohanim to deal with the different limbs, and then there was one kohen to carry out the intestines. So now we're going to start talking about larger animals. Ayil, the ram, korev be'echad aser. Instead of a total of nine, which was for a sheep, and as I mentioned earlier, there were six for the actual animal, and there were additional three kohanim, one that was holding the flour for the korban mincha, one that was holding the wine for the nesachim, and one that was holding the flour for the minchas chavitin of the kohen gadol. So it was six for the actual animal and three for the accessories. A ram, we're going to learn, has more accessories. Ayal korev be'achad asar, with 11 kohanim. Habasar b'chamisha, the limbs with five kohanim, just like a tle. Hakrevayim, but it had larger intestines than that of a tle. Vasoilas, and a mincha that would be brought with it. Vayayin, and the wine from the sochem that we brought with it. Each one of these three items required shnayim, required two kohanim. So therefore, two times three is six, plus the five for the limbs, six plus five is 11. Par, what about a full-size ox? Naturally, that's going to require a lot more kohanim to bring its limbs onto the mizbeach. Korv be'esrim v'arba. There were 24 kohanim that were involved in carrying the ivorim from the butchering area to the ram. So let's go through them. Harosh v'aregel, just like the other animals, the rosh and the regel was first. Harosh be'echad v'aregel b'shnayim. So far we have three kohanim. Then comes ha'ukitz v'aregel. Ukitz is the tail b'shnayim, v'aregel b'shnayim, four. So we're up to seven. We started with three, we're up to four. Three plus four is seven. Then comes ha'chaz of the breast and the geira, and the neck, including the lungs and the heart. Ha'chaz of be'echad, the breast took one, and the geira took three, v'ager b'shlishi. So it's another four. So seven plus four is 11. Then shteyadayim, the two front legs of the animal, b'shnayim. So 11 plus 2 is 13. Ushtei defanos b'shnayim, and the two sides of the animal, the flanks, were also 2, which is 15. So we're at a total of 15, and we're trying to reach 24. So we need 9 more. Where do the 9 more kohanim come in? Hakrevayim, the intestines, vasoilas, and the flour vayayin, b'shloisha shloisha. Each one of these needed 3 kohanim. So that was 9. 9 plus 15 is 24. So that's how it breaks down. Now the question is, we mentioned that the aisle needed two people to carry its soilus instead of one. Two people to carry the yain instead of one. The par needed even more, three. So the question, how did it work? They had individual bottles of wine, and it was one coin for each bottle of wine. Or did they have one big container that had all the wine, and it just took three kohanim to carry that one big container? There's such a silent in the Rishonim how they distributed the kohanim. Zok to Gemara. This was only by the carbon tzibur, the scheduled carbonus, where there was a pious to determine which kohanim got which position. But if it's a carbon yochid, if you want to do the whole thing, you can do the whole thing. There's a lot of different shilas in the Rishonim what this means. There are those who learn that kachik kodeshim, which is belongs to the Rabbanu Shloim, that regardless of who brought it, would have to be split evenly amongst the kohanim with this pious method. But kachim kalim, which is more a personal carbon that belongs to the bialim, he can choose who he wants, and if he picks one person to do everything, that's allowed. There are those who, I believe that's a Teferis Yisrael on the Mishnah says that. But there are those who learn that anytime it's not a carbon sibur, the owner can determine who, if he just donated stam, then it has to be split evenly. But if he picks the coin who he wants to do it, that coin could be entitled to all of the avodah. Then the Mishnah adds another halacha. And this is what I think the Exalti brought it up when we learned it earlier. Have Shaitan Vinitucha. Who did the butchering? We never discussed who did the butchering and who did the skinning. So if Shaitan is the skinning, taking off the skin, Nituchan and the butchering, shall Elu ve'elu of all karbonis shoven, meaning they're both allowed to be done with a zar. And it makes sense because Hefshedin and Vinituchan, that required more of an expertise. So they had permanent in-house workers that could even have been Yisraelim who worked the butchering area and who worked the skinning area. And basically the Kohanim, who were only working once a week, one week a year, they weren't professional butchers. So they just had the honorary positions of carrying the worm from the butchering area to the Mizbeach. But the actual professional work was done by full-timers, by the civil service, and they did the skinning and they did the butchering. So that clarifies what you brought up earlier.
That couldn't have been done in the Azara.
Israel is allowed to be in the Azara for purpose, for work purposes. If he's an essential worker, he's allowed to be in the Azara. And they actually worked the Shechita in the butchering area.
Okay, so I never heard that before.
A Kohen wasn't allowed to be in the Azara, just a loiter. He also was only allowed to be there when he had business there.
Yeah, but I thought a Zohar wasn't allowed at all into the Azara.
I guess he was. We learned earlier on Yom Kippur, the Yisraelim were at the north edge. There was like a strip of area in the Azara on the north and the south. And they, through that strip, they actually filled up not only the edge of Shishrol, but they had a strip on the north and south, which led all the way behind the Beis HaMikdash. So they actually, in certain places, were actually within the Ezra's Kahana. So there's a precedent to that. I mean, we see in other places as well that the Yisraelim were in the Ezra, were in the Zara.
I would have thought that the Kohanim would have been the butchers. Like, why not? They only work 1 week a year. The rest of the year, they could be...
I would have thought...
You sound like a real conservative. You know what they did the rest of the year? First of all, they had to collect their trumas and maasers. They were busy knocking their mishalochim. They ran around from door to door collecting their trumas and maasers. And then they had to learn the halachas to be familiar with them.
Well, they gave us the halachas. That's what we learned yesterday. Right? Shiva Levi and Yisachar. Yeah. They were the ones that gave
us
the
halachas. So they taught. Maybe they taught, yeah. But in fact, their duty was 1 week a year. Listen, even soldiers today in Israel, they work, 1 week a year? They work a couple of weeks a year, and then they have regular jobs. You know, especially if a Kohen had the Keteris, he probably for sure got involved in the stock market or something. You know, he had to do something for the bracha to be chal upon. Okay, Zok to Gemara. Tana we learned, Hef Shaitan v'nituchan shovin b'zorah. The Hefshit and Nituach were similar in their halacha, in that they could be done by a zar. This is a little unusual way of phrasing it, but that's what Rashi says. Oh, so I didn't touch you right. Earlier, we made a distinction between the tzibur and the yachid, between a carbon tzibur and a carbon yachid, how you divvy up the opportunities, but the for hefshet nituach was all the same way. Shoven liyesh ksherim bazar, they were permanent civil service. Okay, before we learn the next Gemara, we have to learn the parasha in Vayikra. But let's just start a couple of lines, a couple of words. Amar Chizkiya asks, Minayin lehavshit v'nituach sheshova bazar. How do we know that havshit and nituach are avoidus, or do not avoidus, and because of that, they're allowed to be done by Yisrael, and they don't have to be done exclusively by the Kehanim? So the Gemara is going to be very interesting. The Gemara is going to go through a parasha in the Chumash, and the Gemara is going to try learning it from Pasuk A, and it gets slugged up. Pasuk B, it gets slugged. Pasuk C shows up. And finally, Pasuk D is where the Gemara ends up bringing the Raya from. So let's just learn the Psukim so that we're familiar with them, because otherwise it'll be a little bit difficult to appreciate. So Zok to Heilige Gemara, Zok to Heilige Torah, Vayikra El Moshe, Vayidaber Hashem Elov, Me'oil Moed Leim. Dabar of Bnei Yisrael, the first carbon that the Torah introduces to us, is a carbon oila that was brought from cattle. Dabar of Bnei Yisrael, Vamar Talem, Adam Kiyakir Vikem, carbon Hashem. Is referring to an oila, and a behema, and a boker, and a tzoyin takrivu. An oila can be brought from either cattle or sheep. es korban. Im oil a karboni min a bakr. Let's first discuss what you'll do if it's a cattle. Zohar tamim yakivenu el pesach oil moed yakir voice lechonil of nashim. Now we're going to start the psukim that the Gemara references. V'samach yodei al roishar. He makes smicha. Who makes smicha? The bialim, not the kohen. The bialim makes the smicha. Only if it's a male. On the keva, a woman who brings a carbon does not make smicha. V'nir tzaloi l'chaper alof, and then he'll be nisratz with the carbon. What happens after the smicha? V'shachat nesben habakar l'fnei Hashem. He shechts. Who shechts? Doesn't say anything about a kohen. So we can assume that we're referring to the same person who made the smicha, that he can continue to shecht it, meaning kosher bizarre. And then the Torah introduces the next avodah with the kohanim. The krivu b'nei Aaron hakohanim es adam v'zorku es adam al mizbeach, which means from kabbalah sadam and onward, it would have to be done by the kohen. Asher pesach oil moed. Then it goes to the next step after the shechita and the zrika. The hishit es ha'oila, it's skinned v'nitach ha'islan zecheah, and it's cut into pieces. No mention of kohanim over here. Then once again, continuing on to setting up the wood and the fire on the Mizbeach, once again, it reduces these avoidances have to be done by Aaron HaKohen, and V'nosnu, we have to focus on the V'nosnu, B'nei Aaron HaKohen, Eishal HaMizbeach, and V'orchu, so there's two words, V'orchu Eitzim Aleish. And then it says again, V'orchu, they set up, V'orchu, they set up, B'nei Aaron HaKohen, Es HaNasachim, Es HaRosh, Ves HaPoder, So it says v'nasnu aron hakohen, and it says v'orchu b'nei aron hakohen, and then it says v'kirboi. So the Gemara is going to start with this pasuk. The Gemara is going to slug it up. Try this pasuk. The Gemara is going to slug it up, and then eventually it's going to get to this pasuk. And this is the pasuk at the end of the Gemara that's going to be the makar of the halacha that even the zohar is allowed to do hefshit and nituach. V'kirboi echrav yichatz b'mayim. The hikter hakohen is a koy lamis becha. So now that we have these psukim, we can glide with ease through the Gemara. Zok the Helig Gemara. Amar Chizkia. Minayin, how do we know? Lehevshit v'nituach sheshove bizar. Shenemar, it says in the pasuk. V'nosnu b'nei aron hakohen eish ala mizbeach. That was the first pasuk entering the phase of Haktorah. And it starts with first setting up a fire on the Mizbeach. And we learn from there, Nesinas Eish Boi Kahuna. You need a Kohen to put the fire on the Mizbeach, but we could be Medayik, but Hevshit V'nituach, the butchering, the skinning and the butchering, Loi Boi Kahuna. Frank the Gemara, you can't learn that from the V'nosnu that's describing the requirements of setting up the fire. Because Haimi Boyle the Gufe, you need the Torah to teach us that a Kohen has to set up the fire. So if that's the case, there's nothing extra here with which you could be medayik that Hefesh V'nituach is not done through a Kohen. So your explanation from Chizkia is problematic. We don't have any extra words here that could prove to us that Hefesh V'nituach does not have to be done with a Kohen. So Amar B'Simon Barashi, I found Abaye was explaining Chizkiah's halacha to his son. And before he jumped in to explain what Chizkiah said, he offered his son an introduction that would help his son understand the halacha that Chizkiah said. And this was his introduction. Vishachat. Right? We learned in the pasuk it says Vishachat, and the Mishnah tells us, Shchita bizar kshera. Shchita is kosher if a Yisrael shechs it. V'chimei ein basa. And Rashi explains, why do I need a pasuk to tell me that shchita is kosher bizar? Why would I have thought otherwise? Zok to Gemara, mechlal shenemar, v'bal the tes in the pasuk. And we had this pasuk in reference to the halachas of which avoidance that if a zar does, he's chayiv misa. And what does it say in the pasuk? Ba'ata uvenecho idcha, you and your children with you, tishru es kunaschem, you should watch your kahuna, and if we slide into the bach, l'chol d'var ha-mizbeach, for anything related to the mizbeach, which means anything that's related to a carbon. So shemei ani, if I just looked at this pasuk and took it at face value, I would assume that afilu shchita. Shchita is also d'var ha-mizbeach. It's the first step in the haktorah. So that should also be required to be done through a kahuna, through tishmas kunaschem. Talmud Loimar, the pasuk tells us, v'shochat es ben habokar lefnei Hashem, without any mention of Kohanim. And then later on, the pasuk says, v'krivu b'nei Aaron ha-Kohanim es Adam. And we learn from there that mikabola v'eilach mitzvas kohuna, the chiyah for a Kohen to do the avodah is only after the Kabbalah. And the Mishnah adds, v'samach yadai, like we saw first, it said smicha, which is for sure referring to the Bailam. Then it says v'shachat, without saying anything about a Kohen, lima, to teach us ala shchita shekshayir bazar, that shchita is kosher with a zar doing it. So let's stop here just for a moment, and let's focus. If the shchita has to be done with a zar, you do find that the kohanim did shchita. It was actually part of the pious. The halacha is, the kohen hedyot, according to certain shitas, wore shatnas. Their garter was made out of shatnas, according to one man d'amar. Because of that, even if the kohen shechted, he would not wear his big day kahuna. Because the kohen only has a right to wear big day kahuna and violate the iser of shatnas when he's doing an avodah that's mandated that he wears those begadim. But since when he's shechting as a zor, he's shechting as a Yisrael, he can use any clothing. He doesn't need to wear his big day kahuna. And therefore, he would not have the a right to wear his big day kahuna, because in fact, it's shatnas, he could only wear his big day kahuna where the big kahuna is necessary. So let's figure this out. So now Abaye, after Abaye gave his son this introduction, now Abaye is getting into the explanation of Chizkiah, how you know that Hefshet and Nituach doesn't need a yid, doesn't need a kohen.
Yasi?
Yes.
Didn't we, could you just explain how we didn't just say the same thing twice with two different lemudim? First we just said it's from min of a shachar es ben habakar lefnei Hashem, so that we see from here mikabaleach is a mitzvah kuna. Then we now start all over again with samachet of a shachar, and since the samach is a zor, so the shachar is a zor. Azor, isn't that two psukim for the same point?
It almost seems like it's two psukim for the same point, but I would venture to say that the limud is from the v'shachar has been lucker v'krivui, and I don't even know it's from a yiter. I just think it's from the way the Torah expresses it, that the Torah only introduces the koyin after the shchita. A, I think it's a dual thing. A, first of all, right before the Torah discusses the Shechita, it discusses Smicha, which is surely the Bailam, which is surely a Zar. After the Shechita, the Torah mentions Rekriva with a Kohen. So since we know for sure, entering this Parsha, we're talking about a Zar, we'll assume that we're not transferring to a Kohen until the Torah introduces the Kohen. So I think it was important for the Gemara to point out that preceding this act of Shechita, without a doubt, it's a Zor. So therefore, it's logical to say that the Veshachat is a Zor because the Torah didn't introduce Kahuna until Hakrov. That's how I understood it. And it's interesting to note that there was a conversation that occurred in Shmuel between Eli HaKohen and Shmuel. And Eli HaKohen was looking for HaKohen to shecht. And Shmuel asked Eli, I don't understand, can't a Zor shecht? And this was the carbon, he was referring to the carbon that Shmuel's mother Chana brought. And Shmuel asked, can't a Zor shecht? And Eli said, you're right, but you're being Moira HaLacha B'fnei Rabbach, that's not allowed. So the shaila is, did Eli not know that Shechita is kesher bizar? So the Mefarshim explained that Eli thought that, and I'm bringing it up because this was Samach, Eli thought that when do you say that Shechita is kesher bizar? That's only if there was a smicha with a zar. If there was a smicha with a zar, so that zar who made the smicha can also shecht. However, the carbon of a woman does not require smicha. A woman doesn't do smicha. So Eli thought that maybe when there's no zor doing smicha, maybe then the shechita would have to be with a kohen. That could have been Eli's havamina, why he only went for a kohen. And then Shmuel said, no, even though it's a woman bringing the carbon and there's no smicha, still the shechita is ksheir bizar. And in that Shmuel, and in that Eli answered that you're being moir halach. But I think that's what the Gemara means, which then would beg the kasha. It should have said this first. It should have first said the samachel b'shachet and then brought in v'hikrivu. So I'm not sure. So your kasha is still better. I was just proposing maybe. Mechi, what was his name? Mechi.
Saying it's brachas lam and aleph on my base. That's where the.
Oh, that Gemara is in brachas.
Yeah.
Shkoyach. Oh, okay, gevaltig. So zok the Gemara, michti. So now Abai is taking over to explain Chizkiyah. We've just established that mikabala ve'elach mitzvah kohen. We've established that anything after kabbalah needs to be done through a kohen. So then the next step was setting up the wood on the mizbeach. Why did the pasuk have to speak out v'nosnu b'nei Aaron lamali? We already know it's post kabbalah. Anything post kabbalah is going to be done through a kohen. Why did the Torah need to reiterate v'nosnu b'nei Aaron? It must be it's extra lamuta hafshit v'nituach. And that explains Chizkiyah. When Chizkiyah said v'nasnu, and Gemara asked, how do you know it's extra? Abaye said, we know it's extra because we've already established that mikabala v'elech needs to be done that by a kayin. So therefore, the v'nasnu is extra. Frank to Gemara, it's still not extra. Even though I know that mikabala v'elech needs to be done through a kayin, I still need the pasuk to say explicitly that setting up the wood and the fire also has to be done by a kayin. Why is that? Bakati itzrich shal kedai techamina kiven the lava avoided the ma'akva kaparahi loisi boi kahuna. We know that once the zrika of the dam of the carbon is done, the bialim goddess kapara. Even if something happens to the meat, it becomes tame, it gets lost, it gets ruined. Even if none of the meat gets placed on the mizbeach, the owner of the carbon got the kapara that he needed. So these, after the zrika, the following avoidas are not ma'akav de kapara. So maybe when we learned that mikabala ve'elech has to be l'kahuna, that's just until after the zrika. But how do you know the subsequent avoidas that are not ma'akav de kapara, how do you know they also need a kohen? Kamash malon, that v'nosnu, the bo kahuna. So once again, I don't have an extra diuk to say that for hefshit and nituach, I don't need a kohen. Elamayelcha, so let's try the very next pasuk. It says v'archu b'nei Aaron akoynes and the sochem. So we just discussed the v'nosnu of setting up the fire. The next step is setting up the pieces of meat on the fire. And it says again b'nei Aaron akoynes and the sochem is a rosh v'sapader. Michli mikabala ve'eleich mitzvah kuna. We already know that's been done by a kohen. And don't tell me that I needed to tell me since it's not ma'akav kapara, because that I already know from v'nosnu that even in avoided it's not ma'akav kapara if it's after the kabbalah needs to be done through a kohen. So v'archu b'nei Aaron akoinim lomeli. Why does it have to say v'archu b'nei Aaron akoinim? It's extra. So I'll say l'mute hefshit v'nituach. Frank to Gemara, who said, maskim, you have a deed from v'archu, which will teach us that there's something else that doesn't need kahuna. Why are you applying that to hefshit v'nituach? Maybe apply it. V'ema l'mute sidur shnei gzira eitzim. We know, we paskin, that the shnei gzira eitzim that are placed on the mizbeach have to be done by two kohanim. But maybe not. Maybe you should learn from V'archu that those two pieces of wood that I put on the Mizbeach do not have to be placed there by Kayana. Maybe we're wrong in the halacha that we assumed. Zok to Gemara, Mistabra Dibcha de Kavasim Emayit. If the pasuk of Archu b'nei Aaron is talking about setting up the meat on the Mizbeach, so it's going to be Memayit something that's also meat. So what's meat? Nituach, Hefshit, that's meat related. So it's the most mistaber to say that if we're being memayit something, we're being memayit meat, that's the subject matter of that pasuk. In fact, Gemara, you could look at it from a different perspective. Adrabba, sidur de kavasa memayit. We're talking about the setting up the carbon. So if we're talking about setting up the carbon, part of that process is putting the wood on. So if anything, maybe the wood is what the pasuk should be referring to. It's not logical to argue that setting up the Sidur Shnei Gizrei Eitzim should not be done by a kohen. It's not mistaber to say that could be done by Yisrael. Because we have another pasuk that indicates, in fact, that it must be done by a kohen. The Amar Mar, which is the next pasuk, the Higrev HaKohen is HaKohel HaMizbecha. The kohen should be makar everything on the Mizbeach, meaning it has to be done by a kohen. Zu halachas evarim lekevesh. This teaches us that the who has to bring the evarim from the butchering area to the kevesh, it has to be a kohen, like we learned. This is extra because we already know mikabala ve'eleich is b'kohen, so we make a deek from there. Halachas evarim lekevesh hu d'boy kohuna. Carrying the evarim from the butchering area to the ramp, that requires a kohen. But halachas eitzim, but bringing the wood to the mizbeach doesn't need a kohen. Now, if the Torah is going out of its way to teach us that bringing the wood to the mizbeach area doesn't need a kohen, it must be that hasidir shnei gzira eitzim boikuna. It must be that the actual placing the wood on the mizbeach must require a kohen, because the Torah is telling us bringing it to the mizbeach doesn't. But from there you know that putting it on the mizbeach itself must be required. So if that's the case, the Va'orchu cannot be telling me that putting the wood on the mizbeach does not have to be done by a kohen, because we have these other psukim which indicate that it must be done by a kohen. So Va'orchu lamali, what is Va'orchu being mamayit? Lamutai hafshit v'netuach. It's telling us that the skinning and the cutting does not have to be done by a kohen. Zok Gemara, but we still don't have a raya because Va'orchu is not extra. Ve'ema hachanami lugufei. Maybe Va'orchu also I need for something else, and I can't use it to be memayit hefshet v'nituach. What is that something else? We're going to have to put that aside for now. The Gemara shortly is going to discuss what that something else is. But right now, we don't anymore have the word v'orchu as an extra available word to teach us anything about hefshet v'nituach. Ella, this is the final answer. At the end of the parak over there, it says, v'ikdur ha-kohen is ha-kohel. Why did the Torah say that coins makter everything? We already know the coin does everything. And that's the end of the sugya. So Chizkia said v'nasnu, but that's not really what the Gemara remains with. The Gemara remains with three psukim later, where it says v'hikter akoyin es akoyel. That's what tells us that hafshet and nituach can be done by a zar. Now, We still have to answer what V'orchu is used for. The Gemara said it wasn't available, but the Gemara didn't tell us yet what it's being used for. So we'll get to it in a minute. But first, the Gemara wants to revisit something we mentioned a moment ago. The Hikra V'akoyin is Akoyin L'mizbecha, Zu Haylachas Eivarim L'kevesh. A coin must take the Eivarim from the butchering area to the ramp. Haylachas Eivarim L'kevesh Hudu Boi Kahuna, Haylachas Eitzim Loi Boi Kahuna. Bringing the wood does not require Kahuna. Hasidur Shnei Gzir Eitzim, but actually putting the wood on the mizbeach, boy kahuna. So that's what we discussed earlier. V'nosnu, which talks about putting the wood on the mizbeach, is lugufei, to teach us that even though these avoiders of haktara are not ma'akiv de kapara, nevertheless, they must be done by a kohen. V'orchu, so now we're going to get to the answer to our question, why is v'orchu occupied? Why can't we use it to teach us that hefshet v'nituach is mutabuzar? Zakti Gemara, V'archu is plural, Shnayim, it's Tukayhanim. B'nei Aaron, once again, is plural, Shnayim, another Tukayhanim. HaKayhanim, which is the next word, which is also plural, is Shnayim. So we have a total of six Kayhanim. Of course, this is a drasha, it's not Pashut Pshat, because V'archu, Shnei B'nei Aaron, and Kayhanim is referring to the same two people. But we're dashing six people. Lamadu teaches us, L'tle, that a sheep, Shaton Shisha. It's another remez that a tle requires six kohanim to bring it up onto the mizbeach. Amar Rav Amnuna, but Rav Amnuna said this is very, very shver. Kasha lo Rav Elazar. Let's bring the pasuk back. We all remember that we were discussing an oila of a bakar, right? That was the pasuk. That's what the pasuk was talking about. Im oila karbanim min bakar. And then it says over here, v'archu b'nei Aaron kohanim, which is speaking about a bull. A bull, hani tamani kayanim, 24 kayanim. So we're going to learn from this pasuk that a tleh only needs six kayanim when it's actually speaking about a bull that requires 24 kayanim. That's what the Gemara asks over here.
So Yossi, in the Mishkan, there's only at one point after the death of Nadav and Avihu, there are only three kayanim. Unless you count Pinchas, it'll be four.
So you're asking me, how did they have enough kohanim to be not these animals?
Right.
Oh, so the answer is really one kohen could have done everything himself. This is because we want to use Beroy Am Hadras Melech. So if you don't have, you don't have.
So you don't need all of those people.
That's
it's
right.
Just, you, what is it? The Rishus? You could use all those?
No, that's the way it's, you're supposed to use as many as those Kohanim.
So
you're supposed to spread it out as much as you can, but this is how far you could spread it, not further.
Okay.
But if he didn't have, he didn't have. So Amar Rav Amnuna, Kashalele Rav Elazar. Hi, this pasuk be ben habakar ksiv. Uven habakar eshem v'arba boy. So how could you prove anything here from Tlat? V'nichale, but the way Rav Elazar answered the kasha was quite simple. Because what does the pasuk say? Ala etim asher ala esha shalom izbeach. Why did the pasuk mention this when it's talking about putting the meat on the mizbeach? We went through the parsha. The parsha lists everything individually. First, to put the wood, then they put the fire, then put the egorim. So why, all the way at the end, when the Torah talks about being makter things, it repeats it all over again. Ala etzim asher ala esha shalom mizbeach. That's extra. So since it's extra, we'll say that it's not referring to the oila ben abokar that we're currently discussing. Rather, it's talking about the carbon tomet. Ezu dover shenemer ba'etzim eishu mizbeach, which carbon mentions that it needs mizbeach, eish, and eitzim, have oimer zet tle. And Rashi tells us even more. Whenever they brought a generic carbon, like an oil bokar, they didn't bring wood. The wood was brought at the beginning of the day to accompany the carbon tomet. So if the pasuk is saying, ala'etzim asher ala'esh shalom mizbeach, it makes sense that we were what is the pasuk saying? We were makir of this ben habakar oila on the wood that earlier in the day when we brought the carbon tomid, ala etzim asher ala esha shalom mizbeach. So it makes sense that we're referring to the etzim and esha, we're referring back to the carbon tomid, which was a tle. So therefore, since this pasuk is referring to the carbon tomid, we can say that it's the six refers to the tle. It's again, it's a drash. Okay. So now what we're going to have here between now and the end of the parak is going to be very simple. We're going to bring Allah from Basim Rabbi Yochanan. The Gemara is going to challenge it with a kasha. And because of that, the Gemara is going to modify what Rabbi Yochanan said. That's going to be this Amud. The next Amud, once again, the Gemara is going to, look, so what I said was we're going to ask a kasha on Rabbi Yochanan and we're going to modify what he said. Then the Gemara is going to say a different option. We'll also ask a kasha on Rabbi Yochanan, but a different kasha. And because of that different kasha, we'll also modify what Rabbi Yochanan said. So the sum total of what we're going to learn is two different kashas that could be asked on what Rabbi Yochanan said. And because of that, we changed what Rabbi Yochanan said to something else so that the kasha shouldn't be sphere. That's really the structure of what we're going to learn now. But it's pretty simple. So let's learn it. And it's a little bit of a chazar. Amar Basi, Amar Rabbi Yochanan. Zor shesider es hamarach. If a Yisrael went and set up the maracha, and the way I understand it is, at the beginning of the day, he set up the fire. I guess things fall off and it gets messy, so he sets it up into the amma by amma square that it's supposed to take up. And then after he would do that, then he would put the shnei gzira etzim on top of it. So first he was misadu the maracha, and then he put the wood on top of it. So what if the czar was just misadu the maracha? He didn't put the wood on top of it. Chayv will be chayv misa for doing an avodah that he wasn't allowed to do. So what do? How do you fix it? If a czar did it, ketzeruaisa parka, he takes the wood, he messes it up again, becharz of a sardu, and then he cleans it up again. Frek gemar maya hanele. If he does it again, how is it any better than it was before? Ela parka czar, the czar undoes what he did. The sardu kain and the kain is mesadur. It's now to kosher avod. So there's actually a machlokes rishonim here. Do you say that he's chayiv misa because he did the aveir already, and now all we're trying to do is fix it so that at least the maracha should be kosher, so that we can bring karbanos on it? Or do you say by undoing it, he actually is also going to save himself from his chayiv misa? So there's a machlokes for showing him whether or not undoing it will actually save him from his chayiv misa. And the reason why it's allowed is because until it's irrevocable, he wasn't oiver. Because the halacha is, what if a Yisrael made kmitza? There he can't fix it. He can't just put the kmitza back and undo it. Because that's in the actual carbon. We consider that irrevocable. But when it's just being beside the wood, which is not part of the actual carbon, that could be redone. and it will save him from a chiv misa. That's what the Chiddush Arim says. I'm sorry, the Sfasema says. Frank the Gemara, Maska for Lord Abzeir. So now Abzeir is going to challenge Rabbi Yochanan's halacha. How could you say that being misad of the Maracha generates a chiv misa for a zar? Is there any avoida out there that's kosher to be done at night, which would indicate that it's not really one of the main avoidas? Because avoida you can't do at night. And it's puzzled with a zar? So how could you say that Sidur HaMarach is chayiv if Sidur HaMarach is allowed to be done at night? Fractimor Veloy, I'm going to give you an example of avoidas that are done at night that are usher for a zar to do. Varei avor mupdor. Being makter, the meat on the mizbeach, we know that could only be done by a kohen, and a lot of that haktorah occurred at night. So, Gemara, it might have occurred at night, but we still give it the status of a daytime avoida, because soif avoided the imami. It's really just finishing off the residual avoidus of a carbon that was a day carbon. So that's considered day, but a night carbon, you still would not be mechuyev for fezor to do. All right, Tumas Adeshin, which was also done at night. The Tumas Adeshin might have been done at night, but it's the first avoida of a set of avoidas that's our daytime avoida. Tomer Basim Rabbi Yochanan, which we had before. Kiddush Yodav of Tumas Adeshin. What if the Kohen got up in the pre-dawn hours to do Tumas Adeshin, and he did Kiddush Yodav Verglayim? Lemachar, when daybreak hits, Einitzarech Lekadosh. He doesn't have to do it again. Because he made his Kiddush Adar Verglayim before the Trumas Adeshin, which is connected to the Avodah Sayyan. So at the end of the day, the Kasha stands. How could Rabbi Yochanan say that a Zohar that was Masada de Marocha is Chayiv if it's a nighttime Avodah? Bela Kasha. Ella, because of that, we're going to have to modify what Rabbi Yochanan said. Ella ki itmar hachi itmar. This is what Rabbi Yochanan said. Omar Basim Rabbi Yochanan. Zor shesider shnei gzirei etzim chayiv. If a zor put the new pieces of wood on the mizbeach, which hoyel avodas yomi, which can only be done by day, if a zor did that, then he's chayiv misa. But if he just was mesadid the marocha, which couldn't be done by night, that's not mechayiv. So basically, we've changed Rabbi Yochanan's pshat to say that he's referring to sider shnei gzirei etzim. And why do we change his pshat? Because of the challenge that an avoida done at night should never be mechuyev misa. Maskevlo Rava. So Rava asked a kash on this. Elamayata tiboy pious. If it's a daytime avoida, if putting the shnei gzirei etzim on the mizbeach is a daytime avoida, it's a first class avoida. So why is it not included in the pious? Zok to Gemara. The Gemara answers Rava. Ishtamitze Rava. I'm afraid you forgot. I'm before Shabraisa. Hadatanya. Misha zocha b'tumas sadeshin zocha b'sidur maracha u'v'sidur shnei gzirei etzim. In fact, there was a pious for the shnei gzirei etzim. So your kasha is not a kasha. You asked why isn't there a pious? In fact, there is a pious. Zok l'mor l'memra the b'avoidus yoyin b'yi pious. Only avoidus that are done by day need a pious. But avoidus laila and avoidus that is done by night loy b'yi pious doesn't need a pious. V'arei evarim up'dorim. Evarim up'dorim are your mark of them at night. Yet there's still a raffle who gets to do it. So the Gemara answered the same thing it answered before. Soif avoided the imamahi. It's an avoida that's just finishing off a daytime avoid. And again, the Gemara asked the same question as earlier. Vare Trumas Adeshin. What about Trumas Adeshin that's a nighttime avoida? And if it's a nighttime avoida, why is there a pious for it? Zok to Gemara, the reason why there's a pious for Trumas Adeshin is Mishamai Shashaya. There was somebody who was killed. There was someone who was injured. So really, you wouldn't make a pious for the Trumas Adeshin. We make it because the other options didn't work out very well. Zok to Gemara, from this shach levataya, we can deduce lememra davoidus yoim vishazor chayiv alamisa, an avoida that is designed to be done by day, and because of that, azor is chayiv misa. That boy pious, that needs a girl. But ein zor chayiv ala misa, if it's an avoided that a zor would not be chayiv misa for, loy boy pious, it wouldn't need a raffle. Aivar shchita. Shchita could be done by a zor and it's still one of the raffles. So if you more, shiny shchita, the tchilas avoided, it's the beginning of the set of avoiders. And because of that, we include it in the raffle. Omar zutra vitemir bash. We actually learned not like what you said. We learned that Sidur Shnei Gizrei Eitzim is not a Avodah by day. You wanted to say that the setting up the two pieces of wood is a daytime Avodah, and that's why Rabbi Yochanan said that Zohar who does it is Chayv Misa. I'm going to prove to you that setting up the Shnei Gizrei Eitzim is not a daytime Avodah. It's an Avodah that's allowed to be done by night. Where do I know it? From the Mishnah that we're going to learn tomorrow to start off the new parak. And the first thing in the morning, Amar Len Hamamuna, the person in charge, announced, told the watchtower people, go see if the sun is shining, because that would indicate that we could now do the shechita of the carbon tamid. Ve'ilu zman shnei gzirei etzim lekatani. Why didn't the Mamuna say, go see if it's light to see if we can put out the shnei gzirei etzim, which would have been done before the shechita? Doesn't say that. So it must mean that the shnei gzirei etzim can be put out even by night. Zakta Gemara, that's not true. The reason why the Mamuna wasn't concerned about the shnei gzirei etzim is not because you could put it out by day. It's not because you could put it out by night. In fact, you have to put it out by day. But he wasn't worried. You know why? The shechitas hatamid, which if you shechted it before you were allowed to, there's no comfort. You got to burn it. It's a wasted carbon. That's what the Tana lists off as the main concern to make sure we hit daybreak. But setting up the Shnei Gzirei Eitzim, that even if you did it at night when it wasn't allowed, you can just take it apart and do it again after sunrise. Therefore, like a tummy. The reason why the Mishnah didn't list off that as a concern to be done by day is because if you did it too early, you can always redo it. So that takes us to the end of the first analysis of Rabbi Yochanan. So we're going to go back again. Rabbi Yochanan said that if a Yisroel was Masadu de Maracha, he's Chayv Misa. Before we ask the Kasha, it's an Avodah of night, and you should never be Chayv Misa for an Avodah of night. Now we're going to ask a different Kasha on the same Aloch. V'ikadamri Maskov lo Reb Zeira, v'chiyesh lach Avodah, sheyesh acharei Avodah u'psul bazar. Do you ever find an Avodah, when there's a set of Avodahs, usually only the last Avodah in the set of Avodahs will be the avoided that's also to be done through a czar. But any of the earlier stages, you never find is possible bazar. So you, Rabbi Yochanan, want to say that setting up the Maracha will be Mechayiv, a czar, that's not the end of the set, that's not the last Malacha. The last avoidah in that set would be putting on the Shnei Gzirei Eitzim. So how could you, Rabbi Yochanan, say to Zechiv Misa for a czar who sets up the Maracha, that's not the last avoidah in the set? The last avodah in the set is putting on the Shnei Gzirei Eitzim. And now the Vilna Gaon and Rashi tell us to skip the first eight lines. And the Gemara says, Eli Itmar, Hachi Itmar. Because of that, we have to change what Rabbi Yochanan said, just like we said earlier. Amar Abasi, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Zor Shasidur Shnei Gzirei Eitzim Chayiv. It's the Sidur Gzirei Eitzim that creates the Chayiv. Why? Because that's the last avoida in the set that makes the set complete. Simple. Maskaflo Rav. So Rav asked a question. Which is a repeat of what we did on the base. If it's an avoida tama, if Shnei Gzirei Eitzim is an avoida tama, it's a complete avoida, why isn't there a special raffle for it? In fact, Gemara, there is a special raffle. V'lai boi pais, v'atanya mishazocha b'trumas adeshin, yizke b'sidur Shnei Gzirei Eitzim. So it is a price. So what's your question? Havikomer, this is what Rava meant to ask. Why is it just an add-on? Why do we just say someone who wins the Trumas Hadeshin, he'll also get the Shnei Gzirei Eitzim? Why don't we award it individually to a Kohen? On that, Dr. Gemara Kedamrina. If you remember, what did we say? After they changed the method of winning the Trumas Hadeshin from a race to a pious, nobody wanted to come to the pious. Because they figured I should get up in the middle of the night in a one in a million chance that I'll be able to do Trumas Hadeshin, I'm not going to come. So what did they do to entice more participants? They added to the reward. And they said, you know what? Whoever wins the Trumas Hadeshin will also win the being Mayrich to Maracha, setting up the Maracha, being Mesada the Maracha, and will also give him the Shnei Gzirei Eitzim. Now it's a more valuable prize. Now people were willing to come out in the middle of the night for that girl. So that's why they had to couple it up together with Trumas Adeshen, because they needed it to give excitement and attract participants to the raffle for the Trumas Adeshen. Zok to Gemara, lememra da avoid the tama, vizor chayavel of misa by pious. The only avoid that needs a pious is a complete avoida, like the Shnei Gezer Eitzim, which is the end of the set. But ein zor chayavel of misa like by pious, but if a zor wouldn't be chayav misa, you don't need a pious. For ishchita, shchita zor is not chayav misa, zor is allowed to do it, and there was a pious for it. Shani shchita that chilas avoided him amahi. Shchita is the beginning of the set of the avoida sayoy. I think we skip over here. I think we skip to Omer Mar Zutra. I believe the Goyin in Beis from Lememra takes it all out and says you skipped here, and Rashi as well. So if Rashi skips it and the Gra skips it, we can feel comfortable skipping it as well. Omer Mar Zutra v'Tamer Ravashi, Afanah Nami Tanina. We also have a raya that the end of the set is the Shnei Gizrei Eitzim. We have a raya that the end of the set was Shnei Gizrei Eitzim, meaning that Sidur HaMarocha is a malacha that's done at night, and the final avoida in that set is the Shnei Gizrei Eitzim, which is then an avoida that's done at night. How do I know that? Omer Lehem HaMamuna, Tzu'u U'ru'u, go look im Higiez Man HaShchita, Vilus Man Sidur Gizrei Eitzim Lo Katani. So that, isn't that a raya that Sidur Gizrei Eitzim is part of the set of the earlier Sidur HaMarocha, which is a nighttime avoida, and that's why the Mamuna wasn't concerned about it? Zok to Gemara, no. Hach the less let the Kanta Katani. Really, the Sidur Shnei Gizrei Eitzim might be a separate avoida from the Sidur HaMarocha, and it might be a daytime avoida. Why wasn't the Tana worried about it? Because the Tana is only worried about Shchita, which if you shecht before sunrise, it's going to be possible. But even though it's supposed to be done by day, setting up the Shnei Gezeirah Eitzim, but if you didn't, you could just take it apart and put it back together again. Loika Tani, the Tana didn't see a need to mention that. And Richard, tomorrow we'll start a new parak.
I feel like when I was in grade school, when the Rebbe used to skip out the Rashis, we'd always go back to see, what's the juicy stuff that he skipped out? Now I have to go back.
So I could tell you what that is. The Gemara quotes kashas here that are the same kashas that the Gemara asked on the earlier sugya, but in the earlier sugya it was challenging an avoided that's done at night. Here we're discussing that it's not an avoided tama, it's not the last avoided in the set. So the questions are not relevant to this approach in the Gemara about avoided tama, and the Gemara puts it in, but it doesn't belong here because the kashas don't make sense over here. They make sense over here, but it seems like someone put it in so that it should mirror the kashas that was asked on the shita that it was about nighttime. But it doesn't really make sense. But Toisvus does make sense of it. There's a very long Toisvus that I didn't have time to understand today. I tried to, and instead of getting a clear understanding of Toisvus, I got a good nap. So I didn't have the Toisvus, but I did get a good nap out of it. But I figured when I woke up, I saw the Gra and Rashi, I figured I'll have to settle